Welcome one, welcome all. My name is Father Drago Șerescu. I'm the principal of the Institute for Orthodox Christian Studies in Cambridge. And it gives me great pleasure to introduce you very briefly this evening, our speaker, Dr. Sotiris Mitralexis, and his topic. And I'm equally delighted that we have among us His Eminence Archbishop Nikitas of Thyateira in Great Britain. And we have had his blessing and his collaboration and that of his close aides in organizing and putting together this conference this evening, both given the topic and also because the Institute and the Archdiocese are hopefully planning to work closer together in the not too distant future with the blessing of Archbishop Nikitas. So welcome, Archbishop, as well. Thank you for being with us. And we welcome a few words from you after the brief introduction that I will make of Dr. Sotiris Mitralexis, as I mentioned. Well, as I said, I'm delighted that this lecture is taking place under this dual hosting session of the Institute and the Thyateira Archdiocese. And Dr. Sotiris Mitralexis is a joy to be with. He is the first of our sabbatical researchers and scholars, the first recipient of this newly established scholarship bursary at the Institute. And what a fine first recipient of this sabbatical research scholarship at the Institute he is. We have been delighted to have him in Cambridge and at the Institute, and I hope he will herald a long line of wonderful researchers that look at Orthodox theology with a fresh perspective and connected to the questions that we have today as people of faith and also as theologians and researchers in our own right. Dr. Mitralexis has been researching, teaching, and publishing widely, and he is associated, as I said, most recently with the Institute, but he has taught and researched at Princeton University in the US. He has been a visiting fellow at the University of Cambridge. He has been a teaching fellow at the University of Athens, as well as an assistant professor at the Istanbul Sehir University. He is currently in Cambridge at the Institute working on two projects. One of them is writing the last chapters of his monograph on 20th century Orthodox political theology and political philosophy of religion in Greece. And its working title is Subversive Orthodoxies. And the other task that he is undertaking in Cambridge is the editing of a collected volume mapping the Una Sancta, Eastern and Western Ecclesiologies in the 21st Centuries, a volume to be published by Winchester University Press. This evening, Dr. Mitralexis will talk to us about Orthodoxy and the public square in the Greek 1980s and 1990s, asking the question, "Behold, I make all things new." And in this lecture, Dr. Mitralexis will examine the issues of, or the term, Neo-Orthodoxy, and all the social and historical context of the development of this term and the setting, particularly in Greece, in relation to the issues regarding orthodoxy, state, religion and society, and obviously philosophy and religion. So we look very forward to your lecture, Sotiris, but before that, I am delighted to give the word to Archbishop Nikitas to say a few words of welcome as well, Your Eminence.
Thank you, Father, and good evening to all of you. It's a joy and a pleasure for me to join you for most of the lecture this evening. I actually had the good pleasure, or I might say the blessing, of meeting with Dr. Mitralexis not too long ago, and look forward to seeing him, I believe, tomorrow evening. As well at another gathering. And I'm very happy that the Institute allows for the ability, the opportunity for people to hear a fresh expression I might say, of Orthodoxy. Too often, I think we're stuck in the stagnant past. The fathers of the church have been covered with dust, and we don't explore them and their realities, their words, their wisdom. And people like Dr. Mitralexis, and actually you, Father Dragos, and those who work with you, are bringing to light so many things from our tradition, and hopefully a breath of fresh air into the United Kingdom and into theology throughout the world. Your idea of a hopeful and better future is a guarantee between the Archdiocese, the Institute, and any not only Orthodox theological activity, program, institute, whatever, but anywhere where we might dialogue and get to know each other better and support one another. Sadly, that which was once called the queen of the sciences, theology, the beauty of words and expression, is being overshadowed by IT, financial programs, all these other things which I consider a little bit useless, because they don't allow so much for the cultivation of the soul, the spirit, the mind, in the true romantic spirit. And I think theology does. Thank you for allowing me to be with you and for our cooperation, collaboration, and I look forward to hearing words of wisdom. Good evening to all of you, and may God keep you well.
Thank you very much, Your Eminence. I think it's with your encouragement and your blessing, it's time to give the floor to Dr. Mitralexis for his lecture. Thank you very much.
Many thanks, Your Eminence, Archbishop Nikitas, for your warm words and for the Archdiocese co-sponsoring this event. Many thanks to everybody at IOCS. Well, given that this lecture has to do with decades, particular decades in Greece and their intellectual history and the relationship of Orthodoxy to that intellectual history, much of the lecture is historiographical, etc. So my thought was to structure it thusly, to present this more historical and social sciences related material in the talk, and then to focus on theology during the discussion after seven. But in a nutshell, if we are to talk about what is new in these developments in Greece at the time, which have to do with the Russian diaspora in Europe, Losky, then Schmemann in the United States, and Florovsky, and a number of other figures, is a focus on the sacramental rather than the institutional, and the question of communal salvation rather than individual ethics, and of tradition not as something that is dead, but as something that can kindle fires when looked upon with fresh eyes, etc. So this would be the crux of the so-called Neo-Orthodox movement. I'd prefer the phrase Neo-Orthodox movement in Greece, theologically speaking. Now on to the more social and historical stuff. When looking at traditionally or predominantly Orthodox countries from the vantage point of countries that do not share this tradition or predominance, for example, when looking at Greece's Orthodox Church from the vantage point of an Orthodox Christian in the United Kingdom, it is easy to assume that the relationship between church and society in those countries do not experience turbulences, that it is more or less immutable. Barring, of course, the exception of the historical experience of 20th century communism and the Eastern Bloc, in the countries of which the church was subdued in varying degrees, only to emerge afterwards with renewed vitality. However, this is an exception that does not apply to Greece. So we easily have this picture of immutability, which is not the case, as we'll explain. Things are much more complex than that. For example, in Greece, the church is usually, from a societal point of view, thought to be politically aligned more to the right wing, at times implicitly and at times explicitly, something which has much to do with the first three quarters of Greece's 20th century history. But there are exceptions to that rule. One of these exceptions is what has been called Greece's Neo-Orthodox movement, a novel and vivid interest in the church, orthodoxy, tradition, and Mount Athos on the part of intellectuals that was very untypical of the way the church was presented in Greece at the time. This Neo-Orthodox movement was not first and foremost about politics and society, but about the church and Orthodox tradition. Yet it was mightily intertwined with social and political developments, as we shall examine. So this lecture leans much more towards the social sciences aspect than the theological aspect per se, and it discusses aspects of Greece's public discourse during those two decades, primarily the 80s, but also the 90s to some extent, with a focus on what has been described with this problematic term, Neo-Orthodox movement. So we offer a re-examination of that movement, that moment, examining the thought of individual intellectuals separately without assuming a given affinity and homogeneity amongst them. That is not the case either way. I would question whether the projection of the Neo-Orthodox label on the developments in the 90s is truly justifiable, and take into account the fact that certain of those protagonists of the movement have entered politics later in life, or have enjoyed a new wave of visibility and popularity in Greece during Greece's financial crisis from 2010 onwards, such as Yanaras and Ramphos. And I'll try to shed light on some lesser known Neo-Orthodox figures as well. But some words about the context, the social, historical, and political context of Greece at the time. A few years after Greece's transition to democracy following the colonel's regime from 67 to 74, and after entering a polity of parliamentary democracy, the people of Greece turned decisively to the left in 81, leading to the victory of Andreas Papandreou's PASOK, the Panhellenic Socialist Movement, as it was called. During this transition and afterwards, the theretofore prevailing national ideology of Hellenochristianity, Ellenochristianismos, suffered an immense retreat, since it had been effectively identified with the colonel's regime and the ecclesiastical coup that came with it, illegally installing a hierarchy sympathetic to it at the head of the Church of Greece during that regime. This happened, this disillusionment with the Hellenochristianity label, happened both as a reaction to the colonel's regime itself and to the earlier pre-1967 right-wing dominated political landscape of the country, coupled with a version of state-dictated Christianity, in a sense, invested in various forms of anti-communist struggle and rhetoric, par excellence during the Greek Civil War. The Zoe Brotherhood, for instance, emerged as a potent arm for this struggle. A broad renegotiation of left-wing identities would take place during the 80s in view of the social, political, and economic transfiguration of the country during PASOK's reign, leading to the brief interlude of a new democracy conservative government in the early 90s, only to continue with PASOK for another decade afterwards. So this was a development that shaped more than 20 years of Greece's late 20th century history. Now, during the 90s, along with the collapse of the Eastern Bloc in general and the effect this had on left-wing discourse, Greece would face more concrete challenges. The Macedonian naming dispute and the breakup of Yugoslavia, which entailed a full-fledged war in Greece's geographical neighborhood. The wider ideological itineraries and shifts during this long period from the 60s up until the end of the 90s would be the object of a study of its own. Here we are merely examining the wider picture within which this so-called movement emerged and flourished. Now, Neo-Orthodoxy, a term without a viable definition. The journalistic, mostly uncritical term, use of the term Neo-Orthodoxy from the 80s till today, pertains generally to a person that would be previously secular or religiously indifferent, atheist, in this particular context, leftist or communist, and so forth, which person unexpectedly shows a public discernible interest in orthodoxy. This would come as a surprise during the late 70s and the early 80s, since such a person would not normally show this kind of interest in Orthodoxy and would not have been positively predisposed to Orthodoxy in the pre-80s period, when anti-religiousness was generally a sign of being, you know, modern and progressive in the political labels of the time. Thus, all those who turned to Orthodoxy at a later stage of their lives during the 80s were often uncritically labeled Neo-Orthodox in journalistic contexts. What does this Neo stand for? Precisely that this form of public discourse on religion, tradition, the church, etc., was markedly different from the version put forth by the state-sponsored Hellenochristianity of the first half of the 20th century in Greece. What is usually now meant is also the dialogue between socialists and Orthodox Christians in the 80s in Greece. People, books, articles, many of them in the magazine Anti, and conferences attempting a previously unthinkable exchange of ideas in search for communalities. That was also very new, very neo in Orthodoxy. This dialogue was made possible through the emergence of a number of public intellectuals who professed both a profound interest and or faith in traditional Orthodox Christianity, and at the same time exhibited a left-wing political action or allegiance. For example, Kostis Moskov, Kostas Zouraris, the musician Dionysis Savopoulos, among others. Now I'm detailing how the journalists would see this phenomenon and come up with this term, not how things truly were. This will come later on. However, to claim that the term is exhausted in this limited circle of intellectuals, or indeed that there is or that there could be a definition accurately describing this phenomenon at large, would be problematic. A number of figures who have been central to what has been described as the Neo-Orthodox movement were never part of the political left and have never identified themselves as politically left-wing. The theologian and philosopher Christos Yanaras would be an obvious example. Yanaras was never part of the political left, nor active in any of its political parties and organizations, nor of the right, though. Yet his attempt to reform Orthodox theology in Greece, as well as his social critique, already evident in the 60s, were not in line with Greece's political right, which dominated the country from the early 50s till 1974. So he was projected to the other camp, as it were. After the 80s now, Yanaras criticized harshly both the political left and right, and he does so till today. Yet earlier eclectic affinities and potential rapprochement to the ideological left should not be overlooked. What, however, can be stated with confidence is that the political left as a whole would never think of Yanaras as one of its members or intellectuals. Now, given that he is a protagonist in the Neo-Orthodox movement, and the Neo-Orthodox movement has been journalistically defined as, you know, church and the left, we see the problems in that definition from very early on. So the fact that many among the so-called Neo-Orthodox were never part of the left creates insurmountable terminological difficulties. It is hardly possible for a definition of a movement to be tenable if the chief representatives of this movement would elude that very definition. Now, defining Neo-Orthodoxy as a new public theology uttered by theologians and people of the church would banish certain key figures from that definition as well. For example, Kostis Moskov, Kostas Zouraris, Stelios Ramphos, who were not theologians. Defining it as a group of former or current socialists turned to Orthodoxy enthusiasts exiles other figures, such as Yanaras. In other words, there can be no viable definition. Yet the phenomenon was there. Something new did emerge. The definition is a problematic part. So in order to approach this current or movement with greater accuracy, some clarifications are in order. Firstly, the term emerged as a pejorative and derogatory one, chiefly from within the left, in order to suppress the then unfolding tendency and dialogue among its ranks. It first appeared in leftist magazines, Thesis and Scholiastis, early in the 90s. The privilege of hindsight discloses the extremity of this hostility with escalating charges such as obscurantism, triumphalist irrationalism, nationalism, etc., abounding. This may be explained as part of an attempt to banish the Neo-Orthodox discourse, or any theological, if you'd like, discourse, or partly theological, outside the limits of what could be tolerated as left-wing by the institutional left, by the secular church of the left, as it were, rather than accepting it as part of its own internal dialogue. So you can see now that the term emerged in order to banish the Neo-Orthodox both from the one camp and from the other. So in general, most representatives of that moment, of that movement, not only reject this term, Neo-Orthodox, as devoid of a fitting semantic content, but have also never provided a label of their own for this moment. So this undermines the certainty that here we're dealing with a movement, because a movement usually wants to be called a movement, etc. Now it needs to be remarked that the term has no connection whatsoever to Protestant Neo-Orthodoxy and Karl Barth. This is just a coincidence. Secondly, three substantively different sets of events and figures can be identified as Neo-Orthodox, pointing to three different levels, three different yet intertwined developments. The theological level, the political level, left-wing to varying degrees, and that of public figures and intellectuals and their impact. Like the unseen part of the iceberg, perhaps the most important element of the current and the one that enabled the others was the theological element, which considerably predates the 80s. In this, Yanaras was the protagonist who shall not be named in a certain sense. Born in 35, Yanaras has been the protagonist of both the new wave in Greek Orthodox theology originating in the 60s, and of the formation of the ideas that lie at the intellectual heart of what has been called Neo-Orthodoxy. Yanaras is now Professor Emeritus of Philosophy at the Pantheon University of Social and Political Sciences, and a public figure of quite some influence in Greece today due to his widely read weekly feuilleton in Greece's premier newspaper, Kathimerini. He has published extensively on ontology, epistemology, cultural diplomacy, theology, and politics. However, and while of course it is easy to name works by Yanaras that have been not merely influential but truly formative in this context, for example, the Greek editions of Person and Eros, first published in 1970, Freedom of Morality, first published in 71, Orthodoxy in the West, 92, all these have been translated into English as well. It is impossible to comprehensively present his thought, so I shall return to the person later on in this talk. What about now Neo-Orthodoxy as a new wave in theology? Neo-Orthodoxy, however one is to define or label it, presupposes the theological turn that preceded it. A theological shift emerged gradually in the 60s, in the midst of turbulence in the Greek Christian movements. That is, pietistic lay organizations of celibate theologians, such as the Zoe Brotherhood, and then the Sotir Brotherhood, which emerged as a splinter group. This shift had a considerable impact on society at large through publications, Sunday schools, affiliated professional organizations of Christians, and so on. During the 70s, some of the most formative theological works, which were fruits of that shift from these brotherhoods and movements to a different era, appeared in Greek. Yanaras is the Freedom of Morality and Person and Eros, as we said. John Zizoulas is today Metropolitan John of Pergamon, a short but immensely influential essay, From the Mask to the Person, published in 85, and then, which then became a chapter to Being as Communion, the famous English book by Zizoulas, Person, the chapter being Personhood and Being by the Metropolitan of Pergamon. And these are only two examples of that theological spring, the books and the new public presence, theological public presence of Yanaras and John Zizoulas, later Metropolitan of Pergamon. It is also in the 70s that Father John Romanides started to teach at the Aristotle University of Thessaloniki, who previously was in the United States. All this overlapped with a parallel and different development. Up until the 60s and the 70s, the monastic communities of Mount Athos were in sharp decline, their numbers being rapidly extinguished. The following decade, however, saw a profound renaissance in Athonite monasticism, with young and educated Greek monks, often with experience abroad, along with several non-Greeks assuming the monastic schema in centuries-old monastic communities. Today, about 2,000 monks reside on the peninsula, something which was decidedly not the case in the 60s. These monks would later prove to be valuable interlocutors for Greek youth with an interest in Orthodoxy, kindled by the socialist Orthodox Christian dialogue. Sorbonne-educated monks, such as the abbot Vasilios Gondikakis of Stavronikita and later Iviron Monastery, would be seen lecturing on Christianity and anarchism to student-filled auditoria. This was very new at the time. These developments, however, were not the chief and primary target of the coinage of Neo-Orthodoxy. This was a political dialogue yet to come. Now, concerning this dialogue, the dialogue between socialists and Orthodox Christians, which was also all too new for Greece at the time. This was a dialogue in the 80s, a development unthinkable in the preceding decades. This dialogue assumed a public nature with conferences, articles, responses, books, etc., building upon the new wave in Orthodox theology that was in the works since the 60s, a reassessment of tradition, of Orthodoxy, and of the patristic heritage took place, as well as an inquiry into the proximity of elements of this tradition to the values of the left, vis-a-vis, in their eyes, the capitalist West and its religio-historical past. So, as it were, a Christianity was sought after that would not be the same as that of the West, etc., even from a secular leftist vantage point in Greece. A convergence of a number of events around 1983 contributed to the impression that a movement was emerging. Firstly, intellectuals speaking enthusiastically about Orthodoxy's value and heritage, being active in prominent political positions in both main parties of the left, apart from PASOK, the Communist Party and the Communist Party of the Interior, acquired an unprecedented visibility in their public presence, spearheaded by Kostis Moskov, born in 1939, reposed in 1998, from the Communist Party of Greece, and Kostas Zouraris, born in the 40s, 1940, who was a central committee member of the other leftist party, the Communist Party of the Interior, Kukue Esoteriku. Kostis Moskov, a historian, poet, essayist, and journalist, came from a prominent upper-class family of Thessaloniki and soon joined the Communist Party. He was the director of the Center for Marxist Studies, so you cannot get it more Communist Party-like, if you'd like. He briefly served as the mayor of Thessaloniki in 81, and from 89 onwards, he was the educational advisor of the Greek embassy in Egypt. So his passionate and poetic writings on Orthodoxy, as well as the fact that he never severed his ties with the Communist Party, speaking from the position of a prominent party member, and in spite of his counterintuitive teachings in a party founded upon historical materialism, exerted a profound influence on that dialogue, the socialist Orthodox Christian dialogue. Most conferences, public debates on that dialogue took place either in or shortly before 83 in his presence. Now, another main pillar of all this impact was Dionysios Savopoulos, born in 1944, a singer-songwriter of iconic status in Greece, then at the apogee of his career, who released in 1983 his studio album Trapezakia Exo, Outdoor Tables, which are now so en vogue during the COVID era, outdoor tables as such. Tendencies that were latent in previous solo albums became much more pronounced here, with Trapezantia actually becoming the soundtrack of Neo-Orthodoxy, as it were, full of both direct and indirect references to Orthodoxy, Byzantine and Ottoman communitarianism, Christian eschatology, and a host of other topics. This was very theological, as it were. A more explicit elaboration of his views at the time is to be found in his numerous interviews during and around 83, while his Neo-Orthodox period continued with his subsequent albums, and particularly in his 1994 album entitled Min Pataxis Tipoda, Don't Throw Anything Away, which is even an eschatological reference in his poetic language. To cite an example of his references to Mount Athos, recounting one of his pilgrimages there, allow me to cite from one of his interviews. Savopoulos says, "These monks are really something else. They are the most extreme people I have ever met. I like to talk to them. I like to hear their stories. There is a luscious anarchism in all of this. Yes, they are anarchists who have come so far that they no longer need to be aggressive like other anarchists. I like their eyes. I like their bread. I like their wine." End of quote. So Savopoulos was and is neither a theologian nor a functionary of left-wing parties. Actually, today he's rather enthusiastically aligned with the conservative government of Greece. However, the influence of his enthusiastic public support for the core tenets of Neo-Orthodoxy, that is, the importance of a lively tradition, the radical ideas that are to be found in Orthodoxy's patristic legacy, Greece's Byzantine and communitarian identity, Greece as a historical inheritor of a cultural counter-paradigm to that of the West, as they saw it at the time, and so on, is difficult to evaluate. Think of Bob Dylan and his turn to Christianity, but on steroids. Arguably, Savopoulos's Neo-Orthodox turn is responsible for expanding the influence of these ideas far beyond the reach of the political and theological dialogue among intellectuals, down to the popular level. Now, another pillar is the chaos that emerged when Christos Giannaras became a professor. His election in 1982 to a philosophy chair at the Pantheo School, which is today the Pantheon University of Social and Political Sciences in Athens, sparked a two-year public debate that made it to the headlines and articles of numerous newspapers. Arguably, turning Pantheos into the first purely left-wing and Marxist university of Greece was the aspiration of many of the left at that time. That is why Giannaras was considered a theologian, so in their minds, a fanatic propagator of medieval obscurantism, according to the secular leftists, and as such unfit for the post of a philosophy professor, even though he held a doctorate in philosophy from the Sorbonne and numerous publications and teaching posts in that field, alongside an undergraduate degree and second doctorate in theology. It is in this context that, due to his undergraduate degree and second doctorate in theology, and in spite of holding a doctorate in philosophy from the Sorbonne, Giannaras would be considered exclusively a theologian. So he may not have been a member or supporter of left-wing or right-wing parties, for that matter. Thus, this episode does not form part of any socialist Orthodox Christian dialogue per se, but it sparked an intense public debate on Orthodoxy, the left, and inquiries on identity, and the question whether, you know, being interested in the church, being a believer, being a theologian even, necessarily means that you are a backwards-looking medieval obscurantists, as they would say. So all this propelled the discourse and its protagonists into the limelight. It is interesting that in spite of the fact that the main definition of Neo-Orthodoxy is usually journalistically confined to this socialist Orthodox Christian dialogue, the at least equal importance of Savopoulos' Neo-Orthodox turn and of Giannaras' appointment to Pantheos has been noted as early as 1984. Another important development is the theological journal Synaxy, to be translated as gathering, fellowship, or sobornost in a way, which was considered the voice of this new wave of theologians, and it published its first issue in 1988. 1982 under Panagiotis Nellis' leadership. Its contributors and the theologians participating in that leftist Christian dialogue overlapped to a considerable extent, although not fully. The fact that pre-existing theological tendencies, that is, the new theological wave originating in the 60s, and particular persons effectively crystallized in a journal just before 1983, certainly played a role in the formation of the impression that a movement, something new, was emerging. Now, the context, however, of the early 80s is of critical importance, the context at large. The left's search for identity during those years in particular, PASOK's ascendance to power, the Socialist Party's ascendance to power in the name of socialism, Greece neither desiring to be an enthusiastic part of the West, since exiting NATO was a core, albeit never realized, aim of the rhetoric of PASOK during the early years of government, nor to be in the Eastern Bloc, of course. All this created some soul searching. The question emerges, where does Greece fit? What is or should be its identity? What does it mean to be Greek or to be left-wing? Emerged as open questions in the public sphere. Thus, while the media reception and representation of the Neo-Orthodox movement was mostly critical and negative, its influence should not be underestimated. It put on the table, as it were, the question of Greece's Byzantine and Orthodox heritage as something that needs to be reevaluated in a very fresh light. And this attracted the fascination of many. After all, Neo-Orthodoxy, in a sense, constituted an identity proposal involving elements of uniqueness and exceptionalism on the basis of Greece's own past and tradition, albeit in a way compatible with left-wing ideas, as well as a cultural juxtaposition to the West without a corresponding alignment with the Eastern Bloc or the USSR. Furthermore, in attempting to understand this moment, the Neo-Orthodox moment, it should be noted that it has been puzzlingly parallel to radical European developments, such as May 1968, For example, Stavros Zouboulakis dubbed it the May 1968 movement in Orthodox theology and ethics. May of 68 took place while Greece was under a military junta, and certain protagonists of that, of what would later become Neo-Orthodoxy, were present in Paris at the time, such as Yanaras, Ramphos, and Zouraris. It is not insignificant that Greece had undergone a rapid and in many ways violent mass urbanization during the preceding decades, with the pietistic Christian organizations such as the Zoe Brotherhood stepping in to provide a substitute of the village's sense of community in the new context of the city. So the movement would later attack this substitute with a charge of westernization in theology in order to voice a penetrating nostalgia for the actual communities of Greece's immediate and less immediate past and their traditions, including their political traditions, that is the communitarianism of the village and the Orthodox popular piety. Another and often overlooked element is the publication in 1983, for the first time, of Greek War of Independence general Yannis Makrianis's Oramata και Thamata, Visions and Wonders, a book of considerable impact. It was published very late, only in 1983, whereas Makrianis, for example, himself lived at the turn of the 18th century to the and died in 1864. Makrianis was an iconic general of the Greek War of Independence, whose memoirs, Apomnimonevmata, were published in 1907. They received the praise of many, including Nobel laureate, diplomat, and poet Yorgos Seferis and poet Kostis Palamas. Makrianis was considered a master of Greek prose, despite his lack of formal education, and his writings exerted a considerable influence on the left, as he was a popular hero of humble origin. Yet, things changed in 1983 due to the publication of the book, Visions and Wonders. This brought to the surface Makarianis's deeply religious nature and the definitive intertwining of his popular Orthodox religiosity with other aspects of his personality, as portrayed in his memoirs, which of course was celebrated by the protagonists of the Neo-Orthodox movement. A public debate erupted, particularly among the left, as this religiosity was deemed incompatible with his status as a hero of the left, and a posteriori hero of the left, of course. We are speaking here about a general of the Greek War of Independence. The humble origins was what fascinated them, and was even attributed, this book, to the purported mental problems, the madness that he experienced during his last years. One of the people who studied, the scholars who studied this period, Xidias, is one of the very few to note the correlation of the publication of this book with the notoriety of the Neo-Orthodox movement at the time, etc. So, now it's a time for a summary of Neo-Orthodoxy's who is who. This, however, poses a methodological and terminological problem. More often than not, varying litanies of names are offered in attempts to identify the protagonists of the movements. A common mistake here is to include names that indeed reflect an intertwining of left-wing, or at the very least not right-wing, politics with a public Christian identity, which, however, would not properly resonate with certain core elements of what has been named Neo-Orthodoxy and cannot be properly characterized as such. An example would be Stelios Papathemelis, a minister with PASOK. Terminological considerations aside, it would be quite safe to name the following figures as protagonists. As stated above, Christos Yanaras should be recognized as having spearheaded the new wave in theology together with Metropolitan of Pergamon John Zizoulas, while also contributing to the socialist Orthodox dialogue from the Christian side. He was participating as a Christian, not as the leftist, in these conferences, etc. Kostis Moskov and Kostas Zouraris are identified as protagonists by virtue of being prominent members of left-wing parties, professing the importance of Orthodoxy for Greece, even for the left itself. Panayotis Nellas, as the publisher of Synaxy, of the Greek Sobornost journal, as it were, Savopoulos as the chief agent of the wider popularization of those core ideas of the Orthodox, Neo-Orthodox movement, and Abbot Vasilios Gondikakis of Stavronikita and later Riviron, a key figure in Mount Athos's Renaissance and the newly ignited popular interest in Athenite monasticism, as we said. Other figures include Father Georgios Metallinos, born in 1940, a professor at the University of Athens, and Theodoros Ziakas, to whom we shall refer to soon. These figures are certainly to be included in the Neo-Orthodox milieu, although not possessing a degree of influence comparable to, for example, Yanarases, Savopoulos, Moskovs, or Zouraris. Theodoros Ziakas, a mathematician and writer, as well as a holder of a managerial position within the Greek state treasury until his pension, has composed, among other treatises, a trilogy of books on what he describes as a social ontology. Although ideologically affiliated to the Neo-Orthodox, Ziakas was not visible in the 80s, was not that visible in the 80s. However, he has exerted an indirect yet decisive impact of Neo-Orthodox thought through his writings, particularly during the latter phase of Neo-Orthodoxy, or more properly speaking, its afterlife, the late 90s and the noughties, the first decade of the new millennium. While many have been tempted to include other figures as well, such as musician Mikis Theodorakis, due to his interest in Orthodoxy, or the novelist Nikos Gavril Pentsikis, the primary protagonists were the ones named, together perhaps with Father Stamatis Kliris, whose son, by the way, now is a very lucid theologian and a very lucid young theologian in Greece, Father Stamatis Kliris, who apart from his theology, also is an iconographer who uses a certain impressionist technique in his Byzantine painting, which was also new at the time. He's very loved in Serbia and other countries, not only in Greece. There's also Stelios Ramphos, who is frequently cited as one of the figureheads of Neo-Orthodoxy. Yet, for a number of reasons, he does not fill the bill for the for this definition. Yet, what is interesting is the following one. Stelios Ramphos experienced a radical turn in his thought in the 90s, after which turn, he said precisely the opposite of what he was claiming before. So before, he was underscoring the vitality of Orthodox tradition, its difference to the Western historical trajectory, etc., the importance of hesychasm. But after more or less 96, he claimed that all this, Orthodoxy, Byzantium, etc., is that which drags Greece to the past and does not allow Greece to propel itself to the future. Now, those that liked the turn, a posteriori made Ramphos as, you know, one of the figureheads of Neo-Orthodoxy, precisely due to the fact that he had repented. So he is now in Greece showcased as the Neo-Orthodox that has repented and has understood how non-vital Orthodoxy is, unimportant or even problematic the Byzantine heritage is, etc. So this is an a posteriori development. Now, what happened after the 80s? Practically, there's only afterlife in the 90s, afterlife of the movement, because there is no stricto sensu Neo-Orthodox movement there. Merely individual trajectories that are to be traced back to this brouhaha that took place in 1983, etc. And there were new problems. For example, by definition, the dissolution of the Eastern Bloc radically changed the context of the Neo-Orthodox movement as primarily an Orthodox Christian socialist dialogue in Greece. This did not have any basis in reality anymore. As such, this would be a phenomenon of the 80s. After that decade, it is very difficult to speak of continuing convergences and much less of a coherent whole that could be named Neo-Orthodoxy. And after 80s, the protagonists of the movement are only to be encountered as individual public figures and intellectuals, university professors, journalists, songwriters like Savopoulos, theologians like Yanaras, and monks with distinct trajectories, and to a large extent, theories. So precisely due to the dissolution of the USSR and the USA's unipolar moment for two decades, as well as the engendering of the European Union through the 1992 Maastricht Treaty, the 90s found Greece in yet another inquiry concerning its identity in a globalized world, in a new soul-searching phase. So public intellectuals, including the Neo-Orthodox protagonists, would find themselves critically debating the narratives on the new global order expounded by works such as Francis Fukuyama's 1992, The End of History and the Last Man, or Samuel Huntington's 1996 book, The Clash of Civilizations and the Remaking of World Order. Other developments were the Macedonian naming dispute in the 90s, which played a significant role as well, and the question of Hellenicity, Ellinikotita, what it means to be Greek, and Hellenocentrism, Ellinokendrismos, which was a more patriotic or nationalistic version of that question, as it were, or a nationalistic answer to that soul-searching question. There were identity crises within the PASOK party, the ruling party of the time, which formed a certain patriotic left, as it was called at the time, patriotiki aristera, discussing the so-called national issues, ethnika themata, such as Greece's relationship with Turkey or the Macedonian naming issue. But this, however, in spite of the fact that it could invoke Orthodoxy at the time, was an adventure very distinct from the Neo-Orthodox current of the 80s. The Yugoslav Wars ignited this even further and had a catalytic impact upon the formation of a new Greek nationalism that also influenced the political left, particularly in view of the more trigger-happy aspects of the unipolar moment. So while many Neo-Orthodox protagonists of the 80s found now themselves in the anti-globalization camp, it could be erroneous to consider that camp as an evolution of Neo-Orthodoxy and to trace such a trajectory. The ideological shifts and regroupings in the 19th were numerous, etc., etc., so there is not too much to be said about that that would make sense in a discussion that focuses on the eminence of Orthodox theology and tradition in the Byzantine past and Athenite monasticism in the public sphere. Zouraris, Kostas Zouraris is another figure. I will be very brief on Kostas Zouraris. He was born in 1940 in Thessaloniki, the son of Greece's first sexologist, Dr. Georgios Zouraris. He studied law in Thessaloniki and then went to Paris, France, where he was an adjunct lecturer at some point at Vincennes, at Paris 8. And as we said, he belonged politically for a number of decades to the so-called Communist Party of the Interior, a non-Eastern bloc-leaning Communist Party in Greece. He certainly rejoiced in employing an arcane vocabulary, which made him, which was his distinctive characteristic in Greece's public spheres. He writes in a purposefully convoluted manner, frequently employing words from classical texts that have not appeared in the vernacular of the last many centuries, and his work is by no means systematic. Seeing that this is the case, summarizing the basic tenets of his thought is a particularly daunting task. But I'll try to summarize some aspects of this thought. By the way, this arcane vocabulary was also fascinating for many, and it is a very creative use of the Greek language. So, in spite of the non-systematic character of Zouraris's idiosyncratic corpus, one could say that drawing from classical and Byzantine sources in the original, Zouraris strives to explore and explain the cultural and political tradition of Greece in a continuity through raptures, starting from the Homeric age via the Byzantine Empire and up to today's nation state. A sweeping grand narrative, which he calls the Iliad Romaico, a non-translatable term, which could be turned as Iliad Romanity. Of course, this Romanity, this Romaico part, underscores the ecclesial, the Byzantine aspect of that identity. So he explores the question whether a Greek cultural otherness exists and concludes that this is primarily, in spite of its classical past, is primarily founded in the community that is the church, not in the institution or in the conviction, in the belief, in the faith itself, but the community of the church as a body, which also, apart from mystical, is also public. He has many sources like Makrianis, again, poets such as Elitis and Seferis, Homer and Thucydides, and Byzantine writers. And he focuses on the community and on two very idiosyncratic terms of his, which he takes from Greek, from the Greek tradition of texts. Synamphoteron, which he takes from Gregory Palamas, and peripu. Synamphoteron means both together, both at the same time. It is used in Palamas for the relationship between the body and the soul, that they are both together in an indissoluble union. Peripu means approximately. By synamphoteron, a word he finds in both classical Greek and Christian patristic tradition, a word employed by Theognis, Demosthenes, Plato, Origen, Gregory Palamas, etc. He refers to a union in which the constituent parts retain their otherness, while the parts united remain unconfused, undivided, and inseparable, following the Chalcedonian Christological formula. That is a union that does not constitute a synthesis in which the parts' otherness is lost and dissolved. So, for him, synamphoteron signals that even contradictory realities may coexist in spite of the paradoxical aspect of the claim. They may have a hypostatic union, as it were. So according to him, the political culture, the political thought of his native Greece is open to this reality in any continuity that this Greece might have. While Western political thought has a tendency to insist in rationally systematizing reality in such a way that a vital aspect of reality, the predominance of synamphoteron, is often overlooked, opting for an either-or type of logic, etc. For him, for Zouraris, you know, pure essences do not exist in the world we inhabit. Everything is mixed. The complicated nature of reality and social political reality in particular is to be affirmed as eluding the claims raised by abstract systematization. Now, in the same vein, following this logic, dualistic formulations are to be discarded in the face of the fact that reality is a vast gray area, a peripu, approximately, and not quite so, as it were, of distinctively different shades, sage of gray, beyond the mere contradistinction of black and white. At first glance, this could seem obvious, but Zouraris insists that this is a distinctive characteristic that has the ecclesial experience of the ecclesial community as a prerequisite in order to for somebody to discern that, etc. And he is very heavy on Byzantine references, hymns. He uses in a political way hymns from the Oktoichos, from the Mineon, from Orthodox's liturgical books, etc., etc., etc. He did enter politics at a later age, during the Greek crisis, actually. I mean, he was elected an MP at a later age, but nothing of that Neo-Orthodox pedigree survived in this career. It is as if by entering politics, one has to cease to be Neo-Orthodox because this cannot be systematized in the everyday struggle that politics is. So, to recapitulate, in this lecture, I try to provide an overview of the social, historical, and ideological context necessary for an inquiry into Neo-Orthodoxy. We can discuss the theological aspect in the discussion, in the Q&A. I have questioned whether Neo-Orthodoxy, with its elusive definition, is indeed a valid term and an actual movement or ideology, showing, among other things, the fundamental divergences between the thinkers usually listed as Neo-Orthodox, in spite of the common traits, these being a positive re-evaluation of Byzantine and Orthodox tradition, a left-leaning, usually but not always, conceptualization of this tradition as a counter-paradigm to what they see as the capitalist West, and a glorification of Greek pre-19th century communitarianism, even if this was the communitarianism of the Christian people under the Ottoman rule. If Neo-Orthodoxy as a whole was anything, then it constituted a reinterpretation of tradition and a hermeneutic proposal of Greek identity over and against not only that of the West, but also over and against the ideology of the Greek state apparatus concerning what it means to be Christian and what it means to be Greek, the Helleno-Christianity which survived up until the fall of the colonial regime in 1974. Neo-Orthodoxy had no institutional subsistence. It was mainly a network of friendships and of the ruptures therein. Now, to conclude, perhaps the testimony of one of the current protagonists, Yanaras, concerning the climate of the time in the 80s, serves to underscore the novelty of the actual events during that decade more than our accompanying theoretical analysis. I quote from Yanaras: "Among the students of Thessalonikian Athens back in the 80s, news like the following ones were heard in a casual way, without surprise, as nothing truly extraordinary, something which was very new. Do you remember the guy from the Greek Communist Party of the Interior's youth? He is now at the Athonite Simonopetra Monastery as a monk. Our other friend, the anarchist, after a long phase into Buddhist Zen teachings, is now a novice monk at the Athonite Monastery of Kutlumusiu. Crowds visiting Mount Athos, friends would go there to meet friends, a restless youth filled the boats from Uranupoli." End of quote. So do bear in mind that as nice as such images might seem, they were exceedingly new in Greece at the time. Before the 80s, Christianity and Orthodox Christianity was part of the ideology of the state apparatus, and there are texts to support how this was chosen to be the case. And we could discuss at another time only too much about Greece's church-state relations, the fact that the Greek church was founded by the state in a schism from Constantinople, from the ecumenical patriarchate, in a schism from the body of Orthodox churches, etc. And prior to that decade, Orthodoxy was considered a rusty, moralistic agent, as it were, in Greek society, sponsored by the state, interesting primarily old conservative people. In the 80s, everything changed. Now the intellectuals that were in the limelight were speaking about the life that is to be found in reinterpreting the fathers and tradition. People were becoming monks, giving a new life to the 1,000 years history of Mount Athos, etc. So yes, in spite of the fact that there was no continuity in that, and that the movement, if we can speak of a movement, died after the 80s, it made all things new. And only from the perspective of eternity can we see whether and how this also breathed a new life to the church itself in Greece, this public discussion. Thank you very much for your perseverance in this 1 hour lecture.
Thank you very much, Sotiris. Thank you indeed for such a rich presentation and for guiding us so eruditely through a very complex and clearly formative period in the recent history of Greece. You have touched on several key issues that I think we can all resonate with, such as identity, what it means to, what we mean by the terms that we use, sometimes casually, what indeed is the content of our orthodoxy, what does it mean to step into the realm of the neo or the new, particularly when identity is concerned, and so on. So thank you very much indeed. Before we open the floor to questions from our participants, I am delighted to offer the floor to His Eminence Archbishop Nikitas for a few words from him. In a sense, some comments, a response. Your Eminence, thank you very much.
Thank you, Father. And I wish to thank Dr. Mitralexis for an amazing lecture of great interest to me personally, especially as I know some of the key figures and individuals you spoke of. And I might say that I missed the names, perhaps, that could have been included in some way, Father George Kapsanis,
yes,
or Kontoglou in some way, and maybe Alexandros Diamandis, from the idea of bringing from literature and ideology. But you had such a great wide subject and brought in so much information, which people like myself, ethnically Greek, as an Orthodox, as a Greek citizen, but an American, so living in the diaspora, trying to grasp the problems, especially the technical ones for the church, in dealing with some of the societies, the paraecclesiastical organizations and whatever, but also these individuals who one day were communists or extreme leftists, such as Theodorakis. And all of a sudden, we see him as a very, not only devout Orthodox, but part of a right-wing party in Greek politics. It's almost incomprehensible to the mind how these things could happen. With not a real question, and I have to apologize because I have to go to another Zoom session in just a bit, is just to maybe for a moment think of what will we do with somebody like Vladimir Putin in Russia, in a sort of parallel situation, and some of the individuals there, KGB, and all of a sudden the voice of Orthodoxy in some ways. How would we deal that? Are there parallels? Do we see similar situations in society, amongst people, things like that? The emergence of a new identity, and perhaps even a confusion of identity, for people. And I'll stop with that.
Many, many thanks, Your Eminence. I'm humbled by your magnanimous comments on my humble attempt. First of all, you are absolutely right on the persons you mentioned. Kondoglu, of course, is not properly speaking a neo-Orthodox, but both Kondoglu's and Papadiamandis' work were immensely influential in this movement. Papadiamandis, precisely one great literary figure, the greatest perhaps literary figure of Greece, offered an image of Greek life and Greek ethos, etc., that was also very, very pious. He himself is called metaphorically the saint of Greek letters, etc. Actually, he was a chanter at a church where a saint was presiding, Hagios Nikolaos Planas, Saint Nicholas Planas. And his writings had an immense influence on Neo-Orthodoxy. Now, concerning what you mentioned about Russia today, etc., I would say the following, I would risk the following assessment, that the Neo-Orthodox current is precisely the opposite of that. In what sense? If the Neo-Orthodox current subverted anything, it subverted the state's claim on Christianity for itself, as its arm, as something that can be used to consolidate state power. What we saw, apart from the church being reinvigorated during the first phases in Russia, is precisely the state choosing to embrace the church, you know, in a struggling embrace, in a suffocating embrace, in order for the power of the state to be increased. So we see, in a sense, precisely the opposite. We see the equivalent would be precisely what the Greek state tried to do up until 1967, trying to use the church for its own aims. Yet, movements like the one we spoke about try to subvert precisely this, because when a state tries to use Christianity to its own end, it never underscores its vital aspects. That is, the whole thing, the whole question is about conquering death, the community that is a body of believers, a public body that cannot be subsumed in a wider body and disappear simply. That the church is not there as a moral police, as it were, which guarantees social peace, something which helps the state. It has another function, another life-giving function. So it is not coincidental that Greek Neo-Orthodoxy was particularly, the theological part, the theology behind Greek Neo-Orthodoxy was immensely influenced by the Russian diaspora. Vladimir Losky, Florovsky, etc., 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 Bulgakov, Berdaev. But the Russian the state version of Russian Orthodoxy does not showcase this this theology today. I don't know if others agree with me, but the impression I have is precisely that the Russian state and the Russian church do not choose to showcase this gem of their theology of the 20th century, the Russian diaspora, precisely because All theological renaissances that manage to find what is life-giving in the church are not obvious to the state, but might be precisely the contrary. So they are not fit for being used in such wider tendencies and developments. That's my humble comment on how Russia is being now, how Orthodoxy in Russia has a public face today.
Thank you, and we'll continue tomorrow. Please forgive me for going.
Many thanks.
Thank you very much, Your Eminence. Thank you, your blessing. Thank you. Wonderful. Well, I think we have about 15 to 20 minutes left for a wider discussion. Again, thank you, Sotiris, for this presentation. I think we have a hand raised by our very own Dr. Christoph Schneider. And if you would like to ask questions, you can either type them in the chat or raise your hand, and I'll try and keep a tab of who's been sort of first, so we have some order, but mindful of the time, about 15 to 20 minutes. Christoph.
Well, thank you, Sotiris, for a great talk. I have two very brief interrelated questions. The first one is, has the Greek Neo-Orthodoxy movement ever given a systematic account of how they envisage the marriage between Christianity and socialism or left-wing politics? That's the first question. The second question is directly related. Has there been a revival of this kind of Christian left-wing thought during the Greek financial crisis? Because what we saw, obviously, Tsipras and Syriza, this is a merely secular socialist party, as far as I can see. Although I greatly admire Varoufakis, but he's an atheist. So has there been a revival, or has there been any other response by the church to the financial crisis that goes beyond merely commenting on, you know, what happens on a daily basis, something kind of more systematic, like the Neo-Orthodox movement?
Thank you very much, dear Christoph. I was so immersed in the second question that I forgot the first one. Sorry, could you give me a hint?
It was just whether Neo-Orthodoxy...
What's their vision? Yes. Thank you very much.
About the relationship between Christianity and socialism, because, that's an interesting topic. Yeah.
Well, first of all, the problem with the Neo-Orthodox movement is precisely that it is not a movement. So many different people would have many different things to say. For example, Kostis Moskov was a member of the Communist Party, truly thought, he died prematurely, unfortunately, truly thought that... Communism cannot but be Orthodox. So this was his idea. Communism cannot but be Orthodox. And he would correct people. Sorry, I'm a communist. I'm not a Marxist. While being the director of the Center for Marxist Studies. Others would have similar tendencies, more or less. Others would think that the monastic polity has elements of interest to socialism. Okay, this communitarian idea, etc. Others, however, Yanaras, for example, who was not part of the left, speaks of a kinonio-kendriki politiki, a society-centered or communion-centered politics, as it were. Practically, this translates in, well, if we are to oversimplify that in a way of butchering it away, we could speak of a progressive tendency in economics and perhaps a more conservative tendency in morality, while, however, not being the prototypical conservative tendency. I would dare to say that the Neo-Orthodox, in a certain sense, were blue label in the UK context. What John Milbank and Adrian Pabst, etc., have to say sounds very much like what the Neo-Orthodox would say when translated in English while changing their Eastern pedigree into a Western one, theologically speaking. Concerning the latter question, there's a number of problems. First of all, precisely because this was not a movement, its continuation, its aftermath, has to do with the trajectories of its protagonists. And these were very different. The church was not radically transformed by this. The church was transformed both by the pietistic, para-ecclesiastical movements, also by Neo-Orthodoxy to some degree, but it hasn't been transformed. The resistance of the church to be changed in that way, in my personal opinion, has much to do with the correlation between church and state in Greece. As it were, in unseen ways, in stealth ways, the state does not allow the church to take on a direction that would be contrary to its own purposes. This is being done in many different ways, which is not of the present moment. Apart from that, you know, there were certain very big promises in the public discourse of Neo-Orthodoxy due to the enthusiasm of musicians, Savopoulos, etc. So many people were enthused by these promises, you know, there I will find a community of love that does not have the problems, the dead ends of Western civilization, etc. And while some people went into deeper than this fantasy, some people were disillusioned later. So while a whole lot of people would speak in such terms in the 80s, this disappeared, the main bulk of those people disappeared later, because they expected that some promises were to be delivered, which they were not delivered. Now, however, tendencies remain. There are also tendencies of Christian leftists that are not neo-Orthodox. There are people who are inspired by liberation theology, etc., in Greece. But if we are to discern any tendency that would be discernible in the terms that you mentioned, it would be the following one. In 2018-19, there was an attempt of a very light church-state separation in Greece, which was proposed jointly by the Prime Minister and the Archbishop. And the Archbishop Hieronymus. This had to do with the salary of clerics. So it was a very, you know, light version of that. This was torpedoed by both the state, the opposition party, and the other metropolitans. But there, the discourse emerged of certain Christians thinking that it is a matter of life and death for the church to be free from the state in Greece. There, you know, this desideratum crystallized. This is a desideratum that does not have a hinterland in the faithful or in the leftists or whatever, but it is a discernible desideratum, the desideratum of desiring church-state separation for the sake of the church, etc., and believing that it is the state that has counter-incentives to that. So that's the only thing I could somehow, you know, draw a continuity on from the Neo-Orthodox in the current crisis. A still ongoing crisis, by the way.
Thank you.
Thank you very much, Sotiris. I think we have two questions, if I have my order right. First one is from Dylan and second one from Constantine. So Dylan, please, you have the floor.
Oh, thank you very much, Dr. Mitralexis. Good to see you again. I'm Dylan Pommen. I'm executive editor of the journal Markets and Morality. So I actually have a follow-up question very much related to the previous one. And that is just in the midst of this movement, you mentioned it's mostly, or if not entirely, you know, left-leaning, socialist. It's defining itself in opposition to its understanding of the capitalist West. But as we know, terms like socialism and capitalism are often very squishy, right? They just emit of a lot of variety and often end up just being politicized versions of economics without actually being, you know, necessarily having any relation to economic science. So I'm actually particularly interested in that. To what extent, if at all, was there interaction with, you know, doing this kind of integration between politics and theology? Was there any intellectual integration as well between any school of economics, and there are many, of course, but any actual economic science and theology as well?
Well, the more hardliners, as it were, in the movement, the so-called movement in the 80s itself, that is the people that were ingrained in communist parties, central committees, etc., 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 would have their say in this, would have something to say. Now, the most important among them, unfortunately, he has joined the choir invisible, Kostis Moskov. So there's not much to say. They had, my memory does not serve me well now as far as names are concerned, but some of the students, as it were, disciples of those people, were turned to the direction of actually studying things such as those that you mentioned. Because, you know, this comes as a sweeping gesture, Neo-Orthodoxy, which sets on the table many, 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 many issues, none of which being exhaustively analyzed systematically, etc. So many people from the second generation would attempt, at times successfully, at times not very successfully, to do that. Now, if I may respond to a question you have not asked, but you might want to ask in a different context, is the following one. In Greece, there was never a theology that would be compatible with free market economics per se. There are certain well-funded institutes that try to say in Greece, like Kefim, Kedro Philelephanon Meleton, that try to say that, no, you know, the ideal version of Christian politics, if you'd like, would be on our camp. But this hasn't been a theological tendency. However, what do we see? For example, in perhaps comparable tendencies in the UK, which, for example, partly ended up with the Big Society project during the Cameron years, etc., parts of Blue Labour, post-liberalism, etc., etc., they affirm communities, I mean, this communitarianism of communities, but over and against the state, not as something that can be translated to the state, etc., etc., etc. This, which theoretically, conceivably, could be a lacuna in the relevant Greek discourse, has not emerged as of now. But purely hypothetically, you know, this could emerge. You know, that a worshipping of communitarianism, of communities and their past, of the way this has been done in the past in a way very different from the impersonal institutions of state or from an individualistic frenzy, yet a communitarianism that would not be state-sponsored as such, or even over and against the state, perhaps. There was an article at some point, because an economist, Nikos Georgiopoulos, a young economist who was reading, you know, the Neo-Orthodox discourse, which he hated, by the way, but there's another topic, who describes himself as neoliberal, said, you know, sorry, all the institutions, particularly as far as tax are concerned, etc., in the Ottoman time of the Christian communities, in the Ottoman time, in Byzantium, etc., are precisely that which I term neoliberal, he would say, but this is a very minority position. For example, the idea then was that there was that the community pays the tax rather than individuals. So there is a certain solidarity as far as the tax is concerned between them. And he said, oh, this is risk sharing or pooling in my language. And I recognize it as something of my own rather than the other way around. So this is not a discussion that has really taken up in Greece, that has been picked up in Greece.
Thank you.
Thank you, Sotiris. We have Constantine and then Elizabeth to follow. And I think after Elizabeth's question, we could prepare to draw the event to a close. But Constantine, you have the floor.
Thank you. Thank you, Alexis, so much. I want to take what she said to an experience I had in 1999 at the other end of Neo-Orthodox. And we were invited in 1999 by the Archbishopric of Athens, Christodoulos, world Orthodox writers and journalists. So for the first time, Orthodox from India, Middle East, former Soviet bloc, Western Europe, Latin America, got together near Volos to thrash out what it meant to be Orthodox. What can we do as an Orthodox community? It was quite fresh. The speaker who spoke to us was someone called Liana Canelli, who was Orthodox, communist, eloquent, and angry. And this was because at the time, yes, our first meeting took place when NATO was bombing Belgrade, so she was in full force. And what emerged from that meeting is what you could call the nouveau neo-Orthodox of the Eastern European bloc, who are like state Orthodox, discovering how Orthodoxy could position itself within the world, and the traditional uninterrupted Orthodox of the Middle East, Europe, etc. We try to form a world Orthodox news agency, which I think the Russians weren't too happy with that. For probably sound reasons. But what emerged, I didn't feel the emergence of a common Orthodox spirit. It was more like getting to know each other. There was nothing theological that emerged, even though there were some priests among us. How would you fit this rise of the Eastern Bloc and the global neo-Orthodox Orthodox awareness with the Neo-Orthodox movement, which you have been talking about?
Well, to be honest, I'm not that well versed in political theologies post Eastern Bloc in other countries in order to be confidently able to voice my opinion. What I would say, though, noting on as remarks on some things that you said, and thank you very much for the comment, it would be the following. One sees how there are persons that manage to consolidate their own role in Greek society and doing very well in doing so, like Liana Kaneli, who precisely, you know, is proudly Orthodox, but not in the old Helleno-Christianic way, in the Neo-Orthodox way, and at the same time, I'm an MP for the Communist Party since all eternity, practically, well, in my living memory, because, but this has never engendered something beyond and apart from the person that has this uncommon, as it were, public presence in Greece. Liana Kaneli, to cite this example, ends with Liana Kaneli. There's nothing after Liana Kaneli. There's no circle around Liana Kaneli. She's an island in the Communist Party of Greece, in which she's an MP, but not a member. But not a member. This is more or less the same with other figures as well. But you mentioned something interesting as well, that we were invited, but there was nothing common. A staple of the whole rhetoric, of the whole, you know, core ideas of Neo-Orthodoxy was precisely the community that is first and foremost the ecclesial community, the actual parishes, actual monasteries, et cetera, et cetera. So when you simply collect, you know, talking heads from here and there, it's the very opposite of a Neo-Orthodox approach to doing things. And Archbishop Christodoulos of late memory was primarily media savvy. That was his primary identity as a public persona, if you'd like. Then he formed a very idiosyncratic form of nationalism, which, however, was not akin to Neo-Orthodoxy, in spite of the fact that in the beginning, due to his friendships and circles like the ones you mentioned, he was called a Neo-Orthodox. It was pure traditional Helleno-Christianity of the Greek 50s, the ideology of Archbishop Christodoulos of the late memory. So we see that even those that were credited as being something different, but were in power, like the late Archbishop, at the very end returned to the state narrative of things, to the state narrative of things. Today's Christodoulos' legacy is purely a Helleno-Christian legacy that draws from the Greek 50s rather than from the developments we discussed about.
Thank you very much, Sotiris. I think we have a last question from Elizabeth. Elizabeth, please.
Yeah, thank you very much. It was a fascinating talk, and the last question also was fascinating. I was glad you mentioned the connection with Russian emigre thought, you know, coming of age in what was then Bishop Anthony's Russian diocese of Sorage in Britain. Not only was that deeply imbued with Russian emigre thought, it was also very much, you know, dominated by Orthodox converts. And from what I knew of Neo-Orthodoxy in Greece, this always struck me as sort of convert Orthodoxy for Greeks. I mean, I don't know how far that's fair. But I'm wondering, you know, to what extent now, because it seems to me that, you know, we sort of even sort of atheism is gaining ground in Greece. And I wondered to what extent there is still a movement of people, you know, rediscovering Orthodoxy in this similarly sort of vital way. I mean, of course, you know, there are always individuals coming back to the church, but is there something similar or not really?
Thank you very much, Elizabeth. That's precisely on spot what you said about the Russian diaspora, etc. And yes, these are Greek baptized converts in a certain sense. All of them, in one way or another. For example, Yanaras, yes, was a theologian, but his clash with Zoe and Zoe's theology was so, so great that it is indeed, you know, finding the faith anew. So these are baptized converts, or a very Orthodox version of born again Christians, if you'd like, which, however, as you can, as one can easily see, share no common points with evangelical born again Christians. But you're right on this. Now, concerning today, I think that Elizabeth's screen is stuck there. Yes. Concerning today, well, first of all, we are having a lecture at IOCS. Most of us are believers. So we believe that the Holy Spirit acts in history in ways that are not always, you know, linear. For example, the Holy Mountain was more or less about to close in the 60s. And then something irrational happened. And young people were flooding Mount Athos. So I wouldn't say that Greece is now experiencing a real secularization that was not already the case, as far as this comment is concerned. Now, on what today is the case? The Neo-Orthodox or their descendants or something, their successors being influential? No. But what is immensely influential and brings people to the church is an unrelated event that, to the eyes of the faithful, is purely God's providence. At least three saints of immense impact who all reposed in the 90s and have been now officially recognized as saints: Saint Porphyrios of Kassokalivia, and practically also of the center of Athens for a number of decades, Saint Paisios of Mount Athos, who influenced the northern Greece primarily, and Saint Iakovos of Evia in the middle of Greece. These were saints that were immensely influential during their lifetimes. Scores of people would meet them every day. Also during the Neo-Orthodox era, by the way, during the 80s, obviously, since those people reposed in the 90s. And after their repose, and also after they were recognized as saints, they have a huge impact that, however, is not to be seen, you know, on television. But if one has an overview of what happens in Greece's Christianity, one can see how influential these were. And because these also had a, particularly Porphyrios, Saint Porphyrios, a very fresh approach to the church vis-a-vis the usual Hellenic-Christian version of things, the Greek state apparatus version of things, in a certain sense, there, in corners there of this impact, this freshness endures. But this is a very popular phenomenon, a very working class, lower middle class phenomenon as well, which means that it is not portrayed in the mainstream discourse of Greece. But this is what is exceedingly influential rather than Neo-Orthodoxy itself today. And there you can see people, you know, saying, I come from a background that has nothing whatsoever to do with Christianity, but I read Porphyrios's book, Wounded by Love in English. Then I met him even after his repose, and now I'm a very pious, you know, church observing Christian. This you can see today due to those three saints, more than due to any Neo-Orthodox movement. Lamentable as this might seem, because I would like the Neo-Orthodox movement to have impact today, but it is what it is.
Thank you very much, Sotiris. Thank you very much to you all for participating this evening. Thank you very much indeed to His Eminence Archbishop Nikitas for his contribution and for the blessing of his presence this evening as well. It gives me sort of a tremendous joy to have participated this evening and to have had this event with you, Sotiris, the very first recipient of the IOCS sabbatical scholarship bursary. It's a huge honor for us to have you at the Institute, and we are immensely proud and delighted to work so closely with you. And hopefully we will continue to cooperate on many projects in the years to come. So thank you again for this evening. With this, again, I thank you all. I pray that God bless you and that you are, and that we see as many of you as we can at one of the IOCS's next events. Do check our website and our Facebook and Twitter and all the other social media outlets for news about our activities. Thank you very much indeed to all. Have a lovely evening. God bless.
I need to also express my cordial gratitude to everybody, to you, to IOCS, to all IOCS people, to the Archdiocese and His Eminence, and to our courageous participants. Thank you very, very much.
Thank you. God bless. Have a lovely evening, all of you. Bye-bye.